Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year. It's MGM 1943. We've got a heartwarming double feature for you. The Human Comedy and Lassie Come Home. But first, our roster of stars at MGM in 1943, as per Joel W. Findler in his book, The Hollywood Story. As always, Findler assigns 1, 2, or 3 star ratings to each person based on his idiosyncratic interpretation of how valuable each star was to the studio during the length of their contract. MGM has a lot of stars, so this will take a bit. Wallace Beery, 2 stars. We've got Clark Gable, who's not actually there for 2 years. This is the one gap in the 30s and 40s. He's in the army. Esther Williams, 2 stars. Katharine Hepburn, 3 stars. Ava Gardner, 2 stars. June Allison, 2 stars. William Powell, 3 stars. Mickey Rooney, 2 stars.
See, I feel like that's wrong.
Yeah, we've discussed this each time around, and I would certainly give Mickey 3 stars. The only thing I can figure is that Findler is docking Rooney 1 star for kind of falling off the map in the late 40s.
I feel like if someone was as important as he was to the studio when he was, I feel like that should be honored with 3 stars.
Are you listening, Findler?
I'm not even crazy about Mickey Rooney.
I am. Robert Taylor, 3 stars. Van Heflin, 2 stars. Gene Kelly, 3 stars. Eleanor Powell, 2 stars. Spencer Tracy, 3 stars. Judy Garland, 3 stars. Walter Pigeon, 2 stars. Elizabeth Taylor, 3 stars. Lana Turner, 2 stars. And Greer Garson, 3 stars. So a lot of the old MGM stalwarts are gone. No more Garbo, no more Crawford. Myrna Loy is just not on there for some reason. Seems like a major oversight. We know Findler's not perfect.
When would you say that we enter the new era of MGM that is no longer glamour and sex and romance and is instead treacle and family values?
Many would say that happens with the death of Thalberg in 37, but there's of course a holdover effect, Thalberg and his personnel. The transition has been going on ever since 37, 38. Many people look at the beginning of the Andy Hardy series, which was really Louis B. Mayer's brainchild. It worked out like gangbusters, and Human Comedy is kind of a relative of those.
You get things still like the Philadelphia Story, which is very much MGM glamour.
Well, it's true. Again, a studio contains multitudes. And Mayer, you know, he had his pet projects that are very different from the kinds of pet projects that Thalberg would have had. And let's hear what John Douglas Eames has to say in the MGM story about our first film, The Human Comedy. Speak of the devil. The Human Comedy was said to be Mayer's favorite movie and was greeted with unbridled ecstasy by the Hollywood trade papers, which were not exactly impervious to his influence.
What does that mean?
I guess they could be influenced.
What, access to stars? Is that the idea?
Elsewhere, some critics reached for words like sugary and over-sentimental. William Saroyan won an Oscar for writing it in his best Isn't Life Wonderful style, preserved by scripter Howard Estabrook and producer-director Clarence Brown. The latter got marvelous effects from a freckled 5-year-old, Jackie Jenkins, who would have stolen the show had Mickey Rooney not given his finest dramatic performance. Others populating Saroyan's small town were, get ready for a very long list of names here, James Craig, Marsha Hunt, Ray Collins, Van Johnson, Anne Ayers, John Craven, Mary Nash, Henry O'Neill, Catherine Alexander, Alan Baxter, Barry Nelson, Daryl Hickman, Rita Quigley, Clem Bevins, and Adeline DeWall. Walt Reynolds. No mention at all of the great Robert Mitchum, who appears in that very same scene with Barry Nelson, who gets name-checked. For some reason, they left out Mitchum.
So what do you know about the genesis of this film and screenplay?
I don't know anything about this movie. I love it, though. I've always loved it.
You do love it, but you've never found out anything about it.
No, not about the genesis. My understanding is that Mayer really shepherded this through and wanted it big time.
This was Mitchum's first feature appearance, by the way.
Even before the Hopalong Cassidy movie, I guess.
So notable. So Saroyan, he's a Pulitzer Prize winner as a dramatist. I believe I read that he refused his Pulitzer Prize, though. Although,
oh, yeah.
Do you know why?
Because it was a commercial award.
Oh, he had this much integrity, did he?
As far as I know, yeah.
So this was an original story that he wrote for the screen, and he wrote a screenplay as well, and he wanted to direct. The screenplay ended up being 240 pages long, and for one reason or another, he was not allowed to direct it. And obviously, neither was that screenplay used. He then turned it into a novel that was published soon before the movie came out. The screenplay for this movie was written by Howard Estabrook. Saroyan did win an Academy Award for Best Story. Howard Estabrook, what things do we know that he's worked on? Well, the screenplay for A Bill of Divorcement.
Cool.
That may be all I recognize. Oh, he adapted with two other screenwriters, Hugh Walpole and Lenore J. Coffey, who we've mentioned often on the podcast. He adapted the Selznick David Copperfield,
oh, cool,
which is a very good adaptation. And guess who was originally slated to direct it after Saroyan was removed from it? Guess who, Dave? Guess who? Who would be your ideal director for this movie project?
Well, he wasn't at MGM, but Frank Capra.
Nope, try again. And this is actually a better fit.
Frank Borzage.
Nope, try again.
Vincente Minnelli.
King Vidor.
That's true, he was at MGM.
So, what would you think of a Vidor-directed human comedy?
Well, that would have been amazing, but I love what Clarence Brown has done here. So, I don't feel like it's a missed opportunity, but sure, the more Vidor movies, the better. I guess he was too busy preparing and making an American romance.
I've never seen a Vidor movie that is this kitschy and treacly. So, I don't know, maybe he would have been able to temper some of the Mayer influence.
Gonna lay my cards on the table here. I love every single moment of this movie, except for the little drive through the celebrating families.
Oh, you mean the Small World After All?
Exactly.
Tour?
I feel like that must have been the inspiration for that ride at Disney.
Well, watching this together with Lassie Come Home did make me think that Mayer's MGM was a template for Disney, especially live-action Disney, which didn't exist yet. Well, this movie is weird. It's uncomfortable in tone.
Yeah, great.
It's, like I said, it's really kitschy and uncomfortably sentimental, not in a Capra. Well, okay, yeah, sometimes Capra does creep me out too, like Mr. Deeds, as I've talked about extensively.
It's aggressively optimistic.
Yeah, what is all that? What's going on with all that? Yeah, Borzage maybe would be a good fit with this creepy afterlife stuff.
I don't feel like this is pandering. This is a singular vision of a real weirdo.
Yeah, it's a singular vision of
a neo-Emersonian.
Really banal weirdness.
You could say Emerson is a banal weirdo too. Saroyan only actually read one thing, The Time of Your Life, the play, which is great, and was made into an excellent Cagney movie in the late 40s. I would like to read this novel.
This movie goes to these super dark and despairing places, but then needs to immediately make everything better.
No, but it doesn't, right? It does not take away. There's so much sadness lingering over this film, and I don't think that it is trying to efface that. It's trying to give people a way to cope with it. That's it. It's saying, well, you can look at it this way. But yeah, there's devastating stuff in this movie. And Frank Morgan is drunk the entire time because he's the one who's got his finger on the pulse of the world with all of this news coming into this small California town. Everyone's dying.
Well, but also he wants to work until he's dead, which he does.
He does. Yeah, this is not a movie that is sugarcoating anything. That's what I love about it.
Well, I feel like it is sugarcoating everything, but I guess you could say it's like sugarcoating a lot of corpses, which is maybe what gives it its creepy, morbid feeling.
I love it. Again, I don't really exactly share this philosophy. I don't think I would write anything like this, but I am impressed that they put something this strange together.
Obviously, there are from what I've already said, there are moments that, even though we overuse this just as much as we overuse Henry James, there are moments that feel very Lynchian.
Yeah.
The most Lynchian moment, like just off the charts Lynchian, is of course Morgan's death and the man listening to the jukebox in the coffee shop slash bar next door.
Well, that's the amazing Hobart Cavanaugh character actor who is just in long shot in those two little segments.
Yeah.
When Mickey Rooney goes to get the coffee.
Yeah, it's a really... See, that there the movie is working on all levels for me for a brief moment.
That captures the essence of what I think of from my limited experience of what Saroyan's all about. He's sort of like California Damon Runyon.
So this movie is aggressively pushing some kind of democratic but also Christian mystic version of America.
Yeah, you can't argue with that.
It is flat out propaganda for whatever the fuck this is supposed to be.
I don't think you could call it propaganda because what, as you say, what is it propaganda? what is it propagandizing in favor of?
Well, let's talk about that.
Not even any kind of denominational Christianity. That's what made me think of Borzegi right away.
Not sure that it includes anybody who's not Christian, but in this... Well, there's a real city called Ithaca in the United States.
Yeah, but it's in New York. There's not one in California.
So
or
I don't
is
know...
there?
I don't know what small town California would be like. Anyway, we do see Mexicans in the small world tour. But it did make me wonder as I was watching it whether anyone who's not Christian is allowed into this... dubious paradise on earth.
It is using some pretty weird Christian language at times, but again, it seems more pantheistic or non-denominationally religious.
And the American democratic vision that it's aggressively pushing is also very much into class reconciliation, which MGM has always liked.
Yeah, well, we're going to see a lot of that this week.
So his own background is relevant to this movie, and then we'll actually start talking about the movie in detail, which is that at the age of 3, after his father's death, he was placed in an orphanage in California along with his brother and sister. And then 5 years later, he was reunited with his mother, who had managed to secure work at a cannery. So he's actually both of the characters in the human comedy.
Yeah, he's
then.
Definitely got some Toby aspects to him.
Yeah, he's both the orphaned boy who comes home at the end in place of the... dead son.
Right, Van Johnson's Marcus. Before we get into the movie proper, I do want to mention, although I haven't watched it yet, I keep meaning to. Nobody likes it, so I'm a little afraid. But 2016, I think, there was a remake of the human comedy. It's called Ithaca, and it was directed by one of my favorites, Meg Ryan. The only movie she ever directed. She also stars in it as the Faye Bainter character.
Well, she's not one of your favorite directors.
I just love Meg Ryan. I want to see what she did, but everyone says it's a terrible movie.
The same people might think this is a terrible movie.
I'm going to watch it one day, and I will report on how I felt about it.
You couldn't make anything weirder than this movie, and I'm sure whatever she did was weird.
And she got Tom Hanks in it, too. He plays the dead Ray Collins' dad.
I should mention, since it came up in the Eames review, I do think this is a great performance by Mickey Rooney.
Who could dispute that?
I think it's incredible. Like, he's 23 years old in this movie. He looks like a dissipated 40-year-old.
Was he already divorced from Ava Gardner at this
point? He's the size of a child. And yet he's playing this really broad juvenile character that has no basis in naturalism. But it's incredible that within that, he can give this really precise dramatic performance. Like, he's totally in control of all of the elements of his performance, more than any actor in the movie.
Mickey Rooney's greatest performances are this film and Life Begins for Andy Hardy.
Yeah, it's a good one too.
He also has to face some tough things in that one. Film takes us into, you know, the life of this small town in the middle of World War II, in the middle of America's involvement in World War II, 1943. A lot of American GIs are already overseas or about to go to confront horrors in the Pacific or in Europe in the lead up to the invasion of Fortress Europa. We're getting to know this whole family. The eldest remaining son is Mickey Rooney, Homer. He's got one brother in the army, Van Johnson, sister Donna Reed, who doesn't get a lot to do in this movie.
No, although she does. Not at all. They do have one little speech about how they'd like to be at war like the men.
Yeah, well, they also have that fun escapade with the three soldiers, including Robert Mitchum. A lot of time is spent with little Jackie Butch Jenkins.
This kid was singled out for his performance at the time for its naturalism, and it's true, because especially, I don't know, contrasting him with Roddy McDowall, though obviously Roddy McDowall's a lot older in Lassie Come Home. But this kid does not seem precocious at all.
No, he seemed pretty distracted and weird, just like a normal 4 or 5 year old would be.
Yeah.
I really like what the Saroyan script or the Estabrook script has him do. He asks some Socratic questions about language.
Kind of important who the narrator is at the beginning of the story.
Yes, it's Matthew, Ray Collins.
It's not just Matthew, it's Matthew's spirit.
Well, he's dead, but he's not gone. He lingers over the family like a warm blanket, and he will revisit them. They are aware of him.
We're going to hear a lot about this, about the way that people remain. By World War II, I believe spiritualism is gone.
Yeah, you can't call this, it's not theosophy style, like, there's no seances, you don't need it.
Spiritualism and theosophy are two different things, but yeah, there's no attempt to get in contact with the dead here. The dead are already with us.
It's a lot more secure and confident about the value that memory has and the value that lived experience has to stay with people.
You can interpret it that way, yes.
There's no irritable reaching after ghosts. They are there with you. If you love them, you can't lose them. I mean, it's more akin to Portrait of Jenny.
Well, but it's also, we're repeatedly told that a good person leaves their impact behind, which is in the form of memory, and who knows, maybe something more diffuse.
Unfortunately, for the people of this town, everyone is good. Everyone. There's no bad person in this movie.
No, we even hear about some boys bullying another boy, but it is asserted by Faye Bainter, Mickey Rooney's mother, who knows all, who is all wise. It is asserted by her that the bad boys are just as good as the good boy.
Yeah.
They're all good boys.
That's right.
So people can do very terrible things, but that doesn't alter the fact that they're all good.
No, that's right. And frankly, we don't see much that's terrible in this movie. We see some squabbling.
These boys are excluding this very, very strange little boy from their reindeer games.
Yeah, they don't beat him up.
They won't let him play. He's not good at football.
That's right.
He also can't read for unknown reasons.
No, but he's quite intelligent and asks some interesting, odd questions and has some weird ideas about the world that are worth exploring. The family's been thrown into an uproar. They're poor. They live in not a very impressive house, you know, considering how many people have to live in it. We're told that the dead father worked at the winery.
They specifically say that he wasn't interested in making money. He just earned enough for them to all live on.
Yeah, so we just picked grapes and helped make wine, and that was it, and supported the family, and now he's dead. The adult son, Marcus, is also gone. He's off to war. Some of his pay comes back to the family, but that's not enough. So the movie starts basically with Homer on his first day at work as a telegram delivery boy.
Right, and he learns a few things about the world, which, as he says to his mother, why are all the things that you learn in life bad?
Or sad.
Doesn't he say bad?
Sad.
All right.
Everything we're learning about the world is sad. And she says, yeah, that's life.
Well, I was thinking of it in terms of the 19th century Bildungsroman, where everything that you learn is bad.
Yeah, but it's very different than that, right? Because the Bildungsroman is often about screaming no at God or whatever. And this is saying, I accept whatever happens and it's all good somehow.
Because the mother says, oh, you'll find out. You'll find out why that is. So I'm waiting in the movie for there to be an answer. There never is an answer.
No, he just leaves it to all of us who also know that so many sad things are happening every day. Trying to deal with it. So Royan's conceit here of having a person on the verge of adulthood learn about the world by being the messenger of doom to all of his fellow citizens.
True. We've seen versions of this sad coming-of-age story before, particularly Four Daughters. Blue Velvet is a version of that kind of story. What Jeffrey learns is definitely very sad about people as well as bad.
Yeah.
He takes it as sad.
Yeah, exactly. Do you agree? This would be a very, you know, if anyone was going to adapt it, I wouldn't have picked Meg Ryan. I would have picked, let's see, David Lynch's The Human Comedy.
Well, except Lynch's sense of evil is pretty damn pronounced.
So. I don't know. I think he could have done it.
Oh, yeah. It would have been a straight story kind of thing from him, though.
Exactly.
Which is not entirely where he lived. Sorry, a little interesting aside that I found out while I was reading about Saroyan is that he made his mark as a writer, initially with a story published in the February issue of Story magazine called The Daring Young Man on the Flying Trapeze, which I thought was interesting because the story is about the Depression, and that is the song sung on the bus in It Happened One Night, Capra's big breakthrough movie. But that also was released in February, so this seems to have been a complete coincidence.
Perfectly in sync, those two. It's a shame they never worked together. Maybe it's just too much for them to combine forces.
Well, Saroyan never wanted to work in Hollywood after this experience with this movie that he wanted to direct.
Right, that he had to publish as a novel instead. But other movies were made of his work. He just, I guess, didn't participate or just sold the rights.
Oh, I don't know.
We'll do The Time of Your Life sometime because it is a really interesting movie.
What I was going to say, related to what we were discussing, is that he did work as an office manager for the San Francisco Telegraph Company, so he's in Homer too.
And also, I guess, in James Craig, who's the office manager at the Telegraph Company.
Right, maybe more in him, who knows?
I really like James Craig's performance in this movie too, so he's sort of the adopted older brother to Mickey Rooney.
Well, he's more than that. He's this ideal boss who is just blazing benevolence, but also has this super weird relationship with Marsha Hunt's debutante.
Yeah. He just seems to have been whisked into this relationship because she's so breezy and won't take no for an answer. But he feels like, no, there's no way, nothing I could possibly have in common with this fool.
But he learns better. He learns that he has been prejudiced because when we meet her parents, we discover that rich people are equally wise and benevolent in this vision.
Yeah, and this does partake of the old MGM, you know, let's not fight approach to class relations. Everyone can come to some understanding. It's not so different from what Jimmy Stewart is supposed to learn in the Philadelphia story, that, you know, the rich can be great too. This could be a swell rich family. He doesn't have to come
yeah,
in acting
see,
like a
we
jerk.
We see rich people behaving pretty fucking badly in that movie. Here, the people we meet are very nice.
Yeah, Catherine Alexander, one of my favorite character actors. She's the mom, and Henry O'Neill is the bedridden dad, very down to earth. And we're told that, yes, he made his fortune. He was a day laborer to start. James Craig warms to the family after he hears that.
Didn't Marsha Hunt say it was her grandfather who was the... Yeah, her grandfather's a day laborer. Her father didn't get his start. It's a little more realistic if it was the grandfather.
Marsha Hunt gives an amazing performance in this movie, I think. She is genuinely odd.
Darling! Yes, darling. I love you, darling, and you love me.
You know you do. There's no half measure adopted here.
Oh, but she has her little moment of gravitas when he says he's volunteered.
Yeah, exactly. We have to believe what he discovers in her is true, that he was wrong when he thought she was a fool. This is just the way she has approached life because she's coming at it from a certain angle. She's just as intelligent and empathetic as anyone else.
She's not just gossipy like her father thinks. As her mother says, I'm sure she's often lonely and serious like me.
Yeah, and this is a revelation to him.
And yeah, to her husband.
If you're ever lonely, I hope you'll come see me. There are no barriers between people that can't be broken down in this movie. Not even death. But certainly anyone who's still alive, there's a chance, a good chance, that they're going to find a way to each other or to understand each other by the end of this movie.
Even the young boy's Wordsworthian adventure, stealing the apricots, this is only play acting at badness.
Yeah, exactly.
They're trying to be bad, but they can't be bad because the owner of the apricot tree is only, well, he doesn't care. He's just putting on a role.
No, he cares. He loves it. And he's like, oh, they're coming to take my apricots again. I love it. And he comes out to scare them away because he's like, well, they're going to get sick if they eat them now. They're not ripe. So I have to come out so that they'll go away and come back when they're ripe and juicy.
So why in a world in which everybody is benevolent and we only ever play act at badness, why is this war happening?
Well, the Nazis are an X factor. Maybe maybe Lynch could get into that side of it.
It's the damn Nazis.
Yeah, well, Nazis are a real problem. Yeah.
So they're not within the purview of universal human benevolence?
I'm not sure. Saroyan doesn't talk about them, right? He doesn't talk about any of the people that America is going to fight. That's just, whatever, that's some kind of cosmic evil that has descended upon the world. So that part is Lynchian too. I mean, there are terrible things happening and nobody understands why, but none of the people we meet are part of the problem.
So back to Homer's first day on the job, he gets some instructions from Frank Morgan about how to deal with his sadness.
Yeah, I mean, don't you love Frank Morgan in this movie? Sure. Isn't this, almost every Frank Morgan performance is incredible in Wizard of Oz and Mr. Matichek, but this one is right up there with those, I think. It's quite memorable, gives him a chance to do a lot of different things without ever getting up from a chair, practically.
True.
And yes, in the event of drunkenness, mine, not yours, he tells Mickey Rooney.
After the boss has supplied them with some pies to bond over. More Lynch.
Yeah, delicious coconut cream pie and apple. They toast each other with some pies. Here we got the core already of the sadness. The reason he's sitting there drinking himself into a stupor is because he's the first one to learn about everyone that's dying. He gets a lot of, you know, unimportant telegrams about business as well. But every night, practically, he's guaranteed to find out that someone has died. Someone that someone in this town cares about.
And Mickey Rooney has to deliver these messages.
Yeah.
Although it's almost as traumatic for him when he has to deliver his happy birthday telegrams too. Singing telegrams. And he sings very badly.
Yeah, I mean, Mickey Rooney was a good singer, so yeah. He is acting this out for us. Well, he does sing the hymn with Frank Morgan in better style, so he's just having a tough night there.
He has to, his first devastating telegram is to this Mexican mother.
Yeah, and if he was hoping to just get in there, deliver it, and get out, that hope is dashed because she says she can't read English, so she needs him to tell her what the telegram says, and of course, just a devastating scene.
She gives him some Mexican candy. It's like a Sesame Street learning episode in the middle of this terrible scene of pathos. It's made from cactus. It's Mexican candy.
And then she sits down and, you know, sings a lullaby, and the camera brings us back in time to, you know, what she hoped for her child.
So this is Mare's favorite movie. Is he on board with this multiculturalism? You're just referring to that Spencer Tracy movie.
Tortilla Flat.
What were they called in that movie?
Paisanos.
Which had problems with stereotypes and also the fact that white people were playing these characters.
Yeah.
So is Mare on board with this multicultural vision?
To some extent, he must have been. Yeah, it's just a rough experience for Mickey Rooney, and of course even more so for this mother who is never going to see her child again.
She calls Mickey Rooney a boy, and that's why she gives him candy. Boys to their mothers who are being slaughtered in this war.
And he goes home at midnight, finds his mom waiting for him. That's where they have that little talk about all the things you find out.
Well, yeah, because he's found out about Frank Morgan, which is sad, and then he's also had this experience with this mother.
And it's a real education for him, unlike school.
I think most triumphant moments of Clarence Brown's direction, one of them is the Frank Morgan death scene that I already alluded to, and the other is the absolute insanity of the scene where Homer comes to an understanding with his school teacher. The feverish lyrical pitch to which it rises.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Mary Nash, right? She's the mother from Philadelphia story.
Very different role for her here.
Well, I mean, this is the main example of conflict that we get in the movie. Homer loves a girl in the class, and she seems more interested in the wealthier boy in the class, Hubert. Hubert is also favored to win the 220 low hurdles.
But only, we learn, because the coach has been especially practicing with him because he is a wealthy kid.
Yeah, the coach is a toady. Coach may be the only really bad man in the whole movie. Because we never see any kind
of... Oh, yeah, and the school teacher is so offended by him. Miss Hicks.
She is offended that this man came in and...
He lied!
Yeah, exactly. She knows the principal wouldn't go against her, and we saw. It's on camera. He didn't. He's like, I'm not going to go against Miss Hicks. You're just going to have to lose the 220 low hurdles. I'm sorry.
So she's all about cultivating these boys' minds and...
preparing them for democratic citizenship.
Exactly. Through both learning and discipline when necessary.
Moral fiber. Preparing them for a world that doesn't exist, which makes no distinctions according to class.
So everyone's going to get an equal start, and then you can compete with each other on this basis. That's what this track meet is supposed to represent, except that then we realize how false that is when this coach shows how the system is rigged.
So Miss Hicks fights back and lets Homer go out there and...
then she cheers them on. But no, it's the moment, the lyrical fever pitch is the moment when they come to an understanding of each other, when he really sees his teacher as a human being.
Yeah.
Because she can perceive the unfairness that he knows exists despite the prejudice of her ideals.
Well, she's been savagely rebuked by the universe here. She was trying to do some good and keep the rich boy and the poor boy together after school for starting a tiff in class, and the powers that be pull the rich kid out, so she releases Rooney to restore justice.
Well, after he's already submitted and said, I'll do what you want.
Yeah, right? That's right.
I mean, this is kind of an unhinged cousin of our town.
Well, yeah,
which
course.
Is already pretty unhinged, but more tasteful. Like, one thing you cannot accuse this movie of being is tasteful.
No, it's out of control. I love it. It gives no quarter. It is daring you to call it saccharine. And then it's going to choke you with that saccharine and emerge victorious. I hope Meg Ryan directed her version in that style, but I'm not sure. So yeah, he wins. In vengeance, Hubert decides to hire Mickey Rooney to deliver a singing telegram.
But as soon as it happens, Hubert realizes he went too far.
Yeah, and again, Hubert's not really bad. He and Mickey Rooney have their reconciliation. That antagonism is cleared up.
Mickey Rooney does tell him as he rides off in the rain, don't try any of that stuff again.
Number three. We never see the girl again, too, that they're of squabbling over.
She's made her choice. Guess the next episode to talk about is this whole lengthy episode with Ulysses and his strange older friend, Daryl Hickman, as Lionel. Lionel is this character. Lionel is an awkward boy. Maybe our viewers understand exactly what's wrong with him, and it's gone quite over our heads, but we're not too sure. As we said, he's not good at sports, and he has a lot of eccentric and passionate ideas, but he also can't read.
All those books.
So yeah, so he takes...
There's another one.
His only friend in the town is this 4 or 5 year old boy, and he takes him on an excursion with him. Turns out to be a very untrustworthy guardian, but it doesn't matter because nothing bad can actually happen to a person in this town anyway, or a child.
No.
And first takes him to the library, and they just marvel at the books, and a librarian does come by to say, why aren't you reading them? What's wrong with you? That's what they're for. Lionel disputes that. I mean, he does want to read it. And then he opens up the book and he shows it to Ulysses. And he's like, they're all saying something. They're all saying something. If only I knew what they were saying.
It's incredible. I love it. There's an A. There's another letter of some sort.
This does seem to be like some kind of weird mystical origin of language experience he's having here.
Yeah, I don't think we're meant to try to pathologize this problem in a real world way. He's just a spokesperson for this desire that all human beings have to attain greater and greater knowledge. And we know it's out there. And how do we gather it? How do we absorb it?
And then this epistemological problem continues after the apricots detour.
That expedition is led by Carl Alfalfa Switzer, you know, one of the main kids from our gang. Mm-hmm. And of course, he's got a major role in It's a Wonderful Life, opening up that swimming pool later on.
It continues when Lionel and Ulysses have this discussion about the word scared, because Ulysses has led such a charmed life despite his father's death that he's never been scared. So this concept doesn't register for him.
No, it's never been phrased to him that way. way.
I do love this weird adventure that he goes on where he finds out the meaning of the word scared.
Yeah, I think the scene is shot beautifully with the mechanical man who is not a robot. Well, 1943, I guess it was cheaper to just hire a guy to pretend to be a robot for 8 hours than to try to create one.
A mime. More employment. Less automation.
That's
even,
right.
Even real people have to play robots. But yeah, so he's abandoned by Lionel because Lionel just has no conception of anything.
They stand there through the entire performance and Lionel's like, okay, it's over. Let's go now. We get a little glimpse into the world of this mime too, right? I mean, he waits all day and all night for a moment when nobody's looking through the window so he can just stop for a while and get a breath or relax. He seizes his moment when it's just this inarticulate, weird four-year-old staring at him and he's like, I'm gonna scare the hell out of this kid so that I can just stand here and not move for a while. So it's motivated on his part to
but
do
this,
it.
This could be just like the apricot tree owner. Like, he is going to scare the kid, but it's not badly intentioned. It's like part of a game.
It winds up being useful.
Useful in that Ulysses learns something, and learning is clearly very important in the movie.
Yeah. He's running through these kind of noirishly filmed streets.
Seems to anticipate another MGM movie, a kid sequence in another MGM movie from the 40s coming up, which is
Meet Me in St. Louis.
Meet Me in St. Louis.
Yeah, it's just the year before, and it's got kind of a similar feel. Even in that one, too, Mr. Broukhoff, that Tootie throws the flower at,
right,
doesn't seem to really be trying to kill anyone or just or murdering cats or any of the other things he's supposed to be doing. You know, we don't get a monologue by him about how he loves to see the kids come to throw flour at him or anything. This movie goes a little further than that. Clem Bevins with his soliloquy.
And it first looks like the movie is kind of breaking through its own premises in the absolute terror of this child, right? And he's inconsolable even when Homer finds him and tries to comfort him until
the word scared is brought in. And then he stops crying immediately. He's like, I'm scared? So labeling emotions, putting words to feelings, making these discoveries.
Well, it seems like, yeah, having a concept for it in itself helps you to manage the emotion. But also it is, yeah, the treating it as a discovery also gives a certain kind of pleasure even to the most unpleasant emotion.
There's a thrill in it.
Which is true. Like, this is very true, I feel, of childhood.
Yeah, Ulysses, he doesn't use these words because that would be truly ludicrous, but he would be like, oh, this is all part of the human comedy.
Yeah, I've had an experience. I've had a new experience. It's very Keatsian.
It is. It's beautiful.
Right? Just no matter how unpleasant the experience, at least it is an experience. And that's what we want, more and more experiences.
Yeah.
Veil of soul making. I've already invoked both Wordsworth and Keats, so we're firmly in the romantic tradition here.
No run-of-the-mill, overly sentimental film, right? I mean, anyone calls it that is really off the mark, I think.
Well, that's what I was trying to get at when I said it was a banal weirdness, because you can't escape the fact that so much that happens in it, so much of the emotional tone in it is banal, and yet it's also, it's definitely not run-of-the-mill, it is definitely consistently weird, and so that's, Lynch is the only thing I could think of as a point of comparison for those two things, right?
And one side of the film that we haven't discussed really at all, since the beginning anyway, when we alluded to the character names, but Van Johnson off in the army with his new pal Toby. And basically, they're spending all of their time at boot camp and in transit to the war theater talking about Marcus's family, because Toby has none and doesn't know what it's like.
Right, but also, this is the most aggressively wholesome portrayal of soldiers at war ever committed to any kind of medium. They do nothing but play the accordion and sing hymns.
Yeah, even Frank Jenks, who's often a real creep.
And speaking of these magnificently wholesome soldiers,
we meet some back in Ithaca as well. Three guys who try to pick up Donna Reed and her friend, but in the nicest way imaginable.
Yeah, these extremely nice girls are just fine about meeting up with these soldiers. It's like Miracle of Morgan's Creek pretends to be on the surface, but actually that movie is like extremely filthy. But this movie is just what it is on the surface. I mean, all they want to do is flirt, go to the movies, and have one kiss.
Yeah, I mean, this is a little bit part of the zeitgeist at the time, right? We've seen Since You Went Away, which has kind of a similar out-of-nowhere appearance by Guy Madison at the bowling alley, who turns out to be a really nice guy even Robert Walker likes, despite the fact that he wants to spend a little time with his girlfriend. He's just a nice boy on his own in the town passing through.
That's not what Preston Sturges thinks about all of this.
But these guys, you know, Barry Nelson, Don DeFore, Robert Mitchum, all destined for pretty big things. Here they've got just this one scene. Barry Nelson is the leader. He's the one that does the most talking. They all get the idea to send telegrams, one to his sweetheart and two to their moms. And then they go to the movies and then they get that kiss. And that just puts them over the moon, and they're playing leapfrog, jumping over each other and pretending to throw footballs down the street after that. Kiss can mean a lot. I'm not going to demean that, especially if you're on your own in the middle of nowhere.
That's what Trudy says to her father. I've got, and to poor Hetty Bracken, I've got to say goodbye to the boys.
Kiss the boys goodbye.
It means so much.
I think it probably did. I'm not going to say that that's not true. Maybe your last decent experience
what the percentages were. There's also Only Yesterday. That has something to say about this as well, that movie. But of course you also had like the Hollywood canteen, where it was the thrill of a young soldier's life just to meet a movie star.
Yeah, just to dance with Joan Leslie.
Or Betty Davis.
Yeah, I mean, these are real things. They didn't go home with Hollywood actresses. It was really just, yeah, here's someone beautiful that cares about me for 5 minutes before I go to die. Tapping into real feelings, not showing you anything but that. But again, that's part of the off-kilter weirdness of this film and greatness of it. Could probably go on for a really long time about this movie. I think we've gotten across the gist of our feelings about it, or my feelings about it. Do you agree that it is a genuinely great film, or do you think I'm a little crazy for thinking that?
No, I don't think you're crazy for thinking that. My own feeling is to be more kind of weirded out by it.
Yeah, well, I am weirded out by it, but that makes me love it. The final bit of compensation that the universe brings, Emersonian compensation, is, well, everything happens at once in a pretty amazing concatenation of horrors and beauty. Johnson is killed. The telegram comes in. It kills Frank Morgan, who is trying to transcribe it half drunk. He knows this is going to destroy Mickey Rooney because Mickey Rooney said he'll spit at the world and become the worst person ever if they kill Marcus.
Well, it's almost worse that that doesn't happen, because then Frank Morgan went to his death believing this, but of course, is he not going to just become a spirit? So that should be fine. But I guess it wasn't a pleasant way to go. We see Mickey Rooney run off to get him his cup of coffee, thinking initially the problem is just that he's drunk.
Blow, you crazy saxophone!
And then we get this insane Lynchian sequence with this guy going on a proto-beatnik monologue about jazz, this drunk guy, as he listens to this music play on the jukebox. Also the first time we see the interior of this place that Mickey Rooney's been running to for the coffee all the time. So that's just deranged. He goes running back into the telegraph office and realizes, well, Frank Morgan's dead in his arms.
Yeah, he's catatonic for a while. He's just sitting there. But when he finally does speak and he goes to play horseshoes with James Craig to regain his bearings, he realizes, no, he doesn't hate the world. He's not going to spit at it just because Marcus died. It didn't affect him the way he thought it would. He still feels benevolently disposed to human beings and everyone in the world. He has to go home now and...
He's very sad, though.
Of course he's sad, and he has to go home and break this news.
He doesn't want to play horseshoes all night.
No. And when he gets home, outside of the building is Toby, Van Johnson's best friend, who's going to come in and help ease the pain of this news. I mean, he's obviously not going to... Again, that's it's Emersonian compensation, but that's always got a tinge of sadness as well.
Referring to Emerson's essay, Compensation.
Yeah, so there is a son gained here, or the son lost, but, you know, there's a residue of sadness.
One of the interesting things about doing this podcast, so covering so many movies and talking about them in depth, is... I started out thinking that the tone and concerns and attitude of Lynch's movies are very unique. You know, Lynchian is a term that's applied to movies, TV, that are influenced by Lynch, and generally the consensus is nobody gets it right. Nobody can really reproduce that.
No.
Despite the wide influence. And obviously there are very specific surrealist movies that have influenced Lynch, and you can find those correspondences. But what I didn't realize is how many movies just in Hollywood history have a tone or moments within them that are Lynchian. So many. And they're not nearly all just in the noir genre where you'd expect to find them.
No, a lot of them are in this genre instead, the family drama. I think it's entirely consistent. I actually think it would be odd for a classic film lover not to be an obsessive Lynch fan as well.
It's like Henry James anticipates all of Hollywood melodrama, and all of Hollywood melodrama anticipates David Lynch somehow.
All right, let's hear what John Douglas Eames had to say about Lassie Come Home. The classic boy and dog story was a bonanza from Dori Shari's unit. Roddy McDowall was the star, but this scene shows two other performers, there's a picture attached to it, starting even more famous careers. Lassie, real name Pal, real sex male, the first top dog at the box office since Rin Tin Tin, and Elizabeth Taylor, already a beauty at 11, and, like McDowall, a London to Hollywood wartime evacuee. With them here are Donald Crisp, Nigel Bruce, and Elsa Lanchester. Again, that's in the picture that you can't see. Others featured in Hugo Butler's potent screenplay from the Eric Knight novel were Dame May Whitty, her husband Ben Webster, Edmund Gwenn, Alan Napier. Produced in Technicolor by Samuel Marx and directed by Fred Wilcox, risen from publicist, script clerk for King Vidor, and test director, and not hindered by being Nicholas Skank's brother-in-law. Well, that sounds like some kind of accusation of nepotism against Fred Wilcox, although he later directed Forbidden Planet. So
he's
very got, interesting
he's
filmography.
Got a weird filmography, yeah. Screenwriter. Do you know anything about Hugo Butler, Dave?
I don't.
I found this interesting to look into. He and his wife, who became his screenwriting partner, Jean Rouverall.
Oh, I've seen that name, yeah.
Were members of the Communist Party, and they were blacklisted.
Oh, wow.
They escaped to Mexico from possible prison sentence. Nevertheless, sometimes continued to submit screenplays that were used under another writer's name as a front.
Sure.
And one of those happens to be, co-written by these two, one of my favorite movies of all time. Can you guess what it is? Obviously, it's something that happened after 1943, and it's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Autumn Leaves?
It is! And now I'm looking really forward to doing The Legend of Lila Clare when we get around to Kim Novak in God knows how many decades. Because they worked with Aldrich again on that, but under their own names. Hugo Butler worked with Dalton Trumbo on He Ran All the Way.
A blacklist festival right there.
John Garfield's last movie before the blacklist killed him.
Only Shelley Winters survived that one.
Can you detect any communist sentiments in Lassie Come Home, David?
No, this one produced by Dori Shari, too.
It was,
right?
Yeah, co-produced.
This one, I feel, has a very conservative bent to it, right? Like, the overall impact of the film, because it really is all about reconciliation on kind of servile terms between this poor family and the Duke. And the villain is, of course, the Duke's evil overseer.
Yeah, Sancho the Bailiff.
Yeah.
And which was making me think of the fact that both Lassie Come Home and, which was based on a famous children's novel, and a lot of those Mizoguchi films from his most famous period from the 1950s, including things like Life of a Haru, as well as Sancho the Bailiff, Ugetsu, how much they all have in common in terms of their archetypal fairy tale structure, including this being sold into slavery and a
yeah.
journey home.
Yorkshire, times are tough. It's before the war, the Depression. Everyone's on the dole, can't support a family or a dog on the dole. I mean, I guess you could make an argument there that yeah, the dole should have been more generous. A noble portrait of these out-of-work men and families, it's just the way it treats the aristocracy that's a bit out of whack.
Yeah, absolutely. Although there are some interesting questions that are raised in the film about what is ownership, and when somebody has paid the $10 for your dog or whatever, does that actually transfer ownership and all that sort of thing, if you really wanted to dig deeply into the concepts of the movie?
There are a lot of nasty criminal bums in this movie, too.
True, but there are also people who are just scraping by with a living, like Edmund Gwenn's peddler slash carny.
Yeah, we'll talk about it all. This movie, it doesn't have quite the same unbelievably outlandish optimism of human comedy, but certainly pulls the tears from you if you are a dog lover or care about people that love dogs.
Oh, yeah. This human comedy didn't make me cry, but this one did, because animal pathos is, and child pathos are like the easiest ways to force tears out of a person.
It really gets you.
I do object to this being called the ultimate boy and his dog movie, because the bond between children and dogs has nothing to do with boys.
Well, of course.
I was absolutely frantically obsessed with dogs when I was a young child, around the age of, I don't know, 4 to 8 or something like that. I had a dog. We were living in a small town. Then my mother made me move to the city. I was doubly betrayed. Doubly betrayed because my mom made me move to the city. So I had to leave the dog with my grandparents in their small town. My grandfather decided that he didn't want to bother to take care of the dog if he wasn't doing it for a child. So she was sent to live with my great-grandparents in the country, who I saw somewhat less of. I definitely believe that dog had her best life out in the country that she could possibly have had.
But you didn't share it with her.
No, I mean, I went out there a couple of times a year. Always really, really enjoyed those visits and enjoyed my dog and their other dog being a part of that. But it was very, very, a very traumatic separation.
Yeah, me too. I've always loved dogs. Haven't had any as an adult. But when we moved from my beloved Verdun to the suburbs, which I hated when I was 11, the only Emersonian compensation there was that we were able to have a dog, Shelley. And she was definitely my best friend through my teen years. I was a loserish teen. She really, absolutely, no exaggeration, was the thing that kept me happy through all of that time. Everything else sucked. Everything else sucked.
Well, my teenage years also sucked. I was also pretty loserish. But yeah. I just, you know, books. It was books, basically, Dave.
Well, yeah, of course. I had all of that other stuff.
And a couple of Smith's cassettes.
Books, music, movies. But Shelley was sitting right next to me every minute of all of that.
Well, I had a human best friend at a certain point. But we probably felt similar ways about them.
Yeah. And then she died very young. Like, she was 6 and a half.
In your arms. This is like a horrible, horrifying story that you told me.
Yeah, we were watching a movie. Our cat was outside, seemed to be getting into trouble. There was another cat screaming at our cat, Marbles. Shelley ran out to help him. I heard like a scream and she fell down the stairs of the patio, and I ran out to get her. She had like a heart attack while I was carrying her back up because she couldn't walk, and she shrieked and her tongue turned white and she died in my arms. Yeah.
It was like Mickey Rooney and Frank Morgan, but worse.
Yeah, it was one of the saddest things that's ever happened to me. It was no doubt.
Someone should make a movie of Dave's experience. No, it's too awful.
It's too awful. Of course, we had amazing times every minute up to that point. The only compensation there was that I was sort of still living at home because I loved the dog. As soon as she died, there was no reason for me to not move out on my own. So I did.
That dog would have kept you living with your parents forever.
Yeah, I was 18. It was time to go. Of course, very intensely invested in dog stories, and this one is well done. It's important for the movie to have its full effect, that you get a sense of, you know, what the dog cares about, who cares about the dog. It's got to have all of that, and this movie does build all of that into it. Roddy McDowall is an important part of the story.
He's a magical little performer. The scene where they first sell Lassie and he finds out and he's just sobbing with the snot pouring out of his nose. It's quite amazingly intense. While Elsa Lanchester pretends to have no feelings, as she likes to do.
Yeah, I really like all of the actors in this movie. I mean, Donald Crisp and Elsa Lanchester, they're sort of like a Matthew and Marilla kind of feel to them. You know, they've
a little bit, yeah,
been through, I mean, they're married instead of brother and sister, but they've been through tough times. They have to put on a brave face, and they're trying to toughen up their kid, but they can't really keep that pose up all of it.
What she's doing is a more straightforward version of Dorothy McGuire's character in A Tree Grows in Brooklyn.
Yeah. Right?
She's doing what the script might more obviously call for than what Dorothy McGuire actually gives it. The Disney structure of a movie.
Yeah. I mean, everyone loves Lassie. They don't want her to go. And they all have their sentimentality about her.
Well, one of the fundamentals of the movie is this husband and wife pretending to themselves. I mean, there's a lot of questions about what animals are in the movie. Because the husband and wife are pretending to themselves that they don't think of her as human. but that's only because they have to make some kind of arbitrary distinction about who gets the limited food.
Yeah.
By the end of the movie, that's broken down when they see the length she's gone to return to them. A lot of questions that the various people who encounter her have about her subjectivity.
Yeah, a lot of people trying to think their way inside the mind of this dog. And we get some shots. The mind of this dog has a clock in it, and the clock is set to final bell at Roddy McDowell's school. Wherever she is in the world, she knows that it's time for Roddy McDowell to exit the school, and she needs to be there.
Well, that's what the father says, Donald Crisp, at the start of the movie. There's something inside her that knows. The animal's not just a human. She's mystical. She's psychic.
And of course, that appeals to a part of any pet owner who has an awareness of a cat or a dog or many other creatures, I'm sure. They do have their own schedules. They do have a certain ability to discern what time of day it is and what they feel like they should be doing at that time of day. But most of it is not as dramatic as this. So she is always waiting by this tree outside the steps of the school. You know, we meet the boy and the dog on what is supposed to be their last day together. And when Roddy McDowell gets home, Elsa Lanchester says, you know, go have a great time with Lassie today. And he's like, why do you say it like that? Why particularly today? And she's like, oh, did I say that? No, just have a good time. But yes, they're intending to sell her because they can't go on and they need an influx of cash. Lassie is a beautiful collie, and the local aristocrat, the Duke, Nigel Bruce, happens to be very into show dogs and could use her for his stable.
It's actually a kind of Austenian, Jane Austen, I mean, conservatism, the way things come about in the ending, which is the promotion of the worthy person to a higher class. In this case, they don't officially become a member of it, they don't marry into it, but practically it's the same thing.
Yeah, well, he gets hired to be the kennel master.
Yeah, I'm sure that's going to have a good salary as well as doing what he loves.
Yeah, I'm going to get paid to raise dogs? I can't believe it. I mean, I can't believe it either. I would like to take that job. We're a long way off from that, though. We should definitely get there step by step.
Step by step, literally.
Nigel Bruce, we see right away, we're not going to be getting a trenchant portrait of evil aristocrats, vampires, sucking the blood of the peasantry, right? Because he tells them, like, this is not a good deal for you. Do you want... I'll let you out of it if you want, Karakov.
Yeah, but he's fucking clueless. It's not like he's gonna go out of his way to help these people or seize them as human beings or anything.
But he's also not exulting in the fact that, yeah, I can swoop in and finally take your dog from you.
True. He's befuddled.
I'm like, Are you sure? I mean, it's Nigel Bruce. It's Dr. Watson from the Sherlock Holmes stories. It's also Beaky in Suspicion, probably his greatest role. Poor Beaky. So he takes Lassie back, and there we meet Scum of the Earth, Overseer, Sancho the Bailiff, Hinds. His name is Hinds. He's a worthless hind. He beats the dogs, mistreats them, resents them.
Middle managers are just irredeemable in this vision of the world.
Yeah, and I mean, it does harken back to 19th century sort of anti-slavery tracts too, which often will present things this way. Like, the most evil person is the overseer. Landholders, you know, they might be just sort of dreamy and out of touch, and they're not really the problem. It's these people in the middle that are cracking the whip.
Well, obviously in Mizoguchi, as we talked about when we did that movie,
Mizoguchi is a lot more trenchant than
that. It's more like criticism of the system as a whole.
Yeah, this
the
movie...
The fact that Sancho the Bailiff ends up being the worst manifestation of it.
You'd be hard-pressed to tease that out of this movie, though. Not gonna try to claim that this is a socialist work.
But both of those movies, as I was saying, and there's the other example that you can think of a lot of people are familiar with who are listening, would be from the Bible story of Joseph and his brothers. It's the selling into slavery archetype.
Lassie, she's just making things worse for herself because she won't eat. She's getting Hinds in more trouble, and the more trouble a dog presents in the kennels, the angrier he gets, the more he mistreats them. Lassie has that call to the school every day, that inner clock. Each time she finds a way to get out of her pen, she digs under the fence. When that gets blocked off, she takes a good running leap and finally gets over it, and that's pretty impressive. The dog had to be practicing that quite a lot to finally get it, because I don't think there's any trickery there. The dog actually manages to clear that hurdle. So she keeps coming back. Roddy McDowell and Lassie run off to the moors like Kathy and Heathcliff. They're going to live out there and hide in a cave, but they're found immediately.
The movie kind of made me wish Elizabeth Taylor had played Kathy. Not at this age. Well, I mean, also at this age.
She does appear in Jane Eyre. You know, beautiful, mistreated child at the school. They have an ally inside the Duke's camp, and that's Elizabeth Taylor. She is one of the first people that becomes completely fascinated by what is going on in Lassie's mind. Why is she so different from all the other dogs on their property?
And what a remarkable young actress she is. Because, I mean, she has almost no screen time in this movie, but she's so smart. She just, like, radiates empathy.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely believable that she has this perceptiveness about her.
And she's got her eye on Hines. She is teaming up with Lassie to try to mitigate his evil, because Nigel Bruce, again, is off harumphing and being ineffectual. When he finally does get angry, though, I mean, I guess here you could see, maybe this was put in there by the socialists, you could see the making of an evil overseer, evil middle manager, because he does get really dressed down by the Duke on a few occasions, but he's so gross and evil that you kind of enjoy it, but that's not right. You know, we shouldn't be enjoying the owner of the means of production cracking down on a servant. But yeah, that's kind of the bind that this movie leaves you in, because he's being so mean to Lassie.
I think the way you have to look at it is very abstractly and very archetypally, as there is an evil reign that is going to be lifted by the end of the movie.
Yeah, but again, it's not the ruler.
It's not the right evil reign, yes. But there's just a period of hell that is prevalent, that is going to, you know, like the Book of Job or whatever, that is going to be resolved in the ending.
Yeah, or like in Lord of the Rings, with the king that's kind of fallen into a catatonic stupor, and there's like an evil force murmuring to him to tell him what to do, and they have to get it out. But
Yeah. Kind of like the archetype in Joseph Losey's The Servant.
Yeah, but it's not quite like that, because Hines doesn't really seem to have the ear of Nigel Bruce. Nigel Bruce is just not paying enough attention, and when he does, he yells at Hines.
Yeah, there's a disconnect. What becomes the reconnection, the point of reconnection, where the befuddled but benign king is brought to his attention what's happening in the land through Elizabeth Taylor's character.
Yeah, I guess there's a little bit of a Robin Hood kind of thing, too. Sheriff of Nottingham.
Sure.
Is Hines, and good King Richard is what Nigel Bruce finally becomes.
He's not a good king.
No, he's not.
He's not. He's just...
Well, Richard was a terrible king.
Like I said, he's just benign. That's the best you can say about this character.
Yeah, we should just make Elizabeth Taylor the Duchess and get rid of this guy. They finally realize the only solution to this problem, Lassie's going to get out every single day, no matter what they do. They have to just take her to Scotland, to another castle the Duke owns. That should put an end to it.
Well, I think she's taken there because there's, like, a dog show or something.
Well, yeah, but it also should put an end to this problem of running away back to the Carrickcloughs on the moors, because it's hundreds of miles away. Dogs can't get across that amount of space, but this dog can. But she couldn't actually achieve what she achieves without the assistance of Elizabeth Taylor. They outwit Hines, once again. He's forced to take her for a walk because he's got her tied up in the pen, and he's berated for that. Of course, that's not good for a show dog. It's going to affect her ability to perform, and her posture is going to be bad, etc., etc. So, of course, Lassie is too smart for him and gets away from him. She wouldn't have been able to get off this giant estate, though. That fence looks pretty high, and Elizabeth Taylor opens the gate. And, of course, Nigel Bruce is standing right there watching it, and he seems all right with it. It's really just Hines who's angry. He is going to get in trouble for it, even if everyone's happy that the dog got away. You could do a whole movie or novel from Hines' perspective and just watch the making of this monster. I think that would be interesting. Possibly that is the wedge that the screenwriters put in there for you to think about a little bit. Like, why is this world set up entirely to make this guy seem like the bad guy only?
I think this is a pretty standard archetype, but yeah, definitely one that could be deconstructed.
It draws attention to itself more than any other narrative of this kind that I've ever seen, I think. Like, how servile he is, while also being apparently the only person that wants to keep Lassie trapped. Everyone else is great with her going on this adventure.
Well, everyone else even the sort of idiot that Nigel Bruce is, everyone else can see the nobility of this dog, but this middle manager is so sunk in this awful pragmatism and this servant role that the finer things in life, the graces of life, completely escape him.
He's blind to it, sees nothing special about Lassie at all. And the fact that other people start to think she's special just makes him hate her more.
She's just a source of trouble for him.
So she gets away and she begins her journey. Beautifully shot. I mean, they spared no expense, it seems, in creating these Technicolor landscapes for her to roam through.
Apparently this is supposed to be a black and white movie. Not spectacular at all. But once they started using Pal the stunt dog in a few sequences, they could really see the potential of it. And so the female Lassie got booted out of the movie. And Pal became Lassie, and it became a Technicolor movie and turned into what we see.
So all the feature films and the TV shows, are they all Pal and descendants of Pal? Is that right?
Well, yeah, they're Pal up to the pilots of the TV show, and then Son of Pal takes over.
Right. Those shows are great. June Lockhart.
Completely different setting.
Yeah.
Lassie Jr. Apparently that was the name of Son of Pal.
So the journey begins, and there's a lot of harrowing stuff that occurs. I mean, we see blood on the rocks as the dog navigates coasts of Scotland.
Maybe I would have felt differently as a child. As an adult watching this, I never really occupy the perspective of the dog. I think as a child I probably would have, but as an adult, it's more and more viewing her externally through the people she encounters.
No, I think I was feeling it more through the dog. Maybe I'm just a child. The first people she runs across are two poor guys who are hired to watch over a flock and shoot any being that comes near them.
They are middle manager types too, but one is good and one is bad.
Well, did you recognize them? I mean, one is Alan Napier, the one who is well disposed toward Lassie, and then the other guy is Barry Fitzgerald. This is one of his last, you know, non-star roles, because very soon he's going to be in Going My Way and he's going to become a much bigger deal. This is a smaller role, certainly, than Aloysius Gogarty. All he's doing is talking about killing the dog and his own monster, Satan, that he sends after Lassie.
Does he just want the reward?
Yeah.
Yeah, but the other guy doesn't want to shoot unless necessary.
No, he's like, that dog seems like she's going somewhere. And we already love Lassie anyway. I'm not sure it needed to do this, but it does show her in a cave the night before, sleeping peacefully next to a whole flock without damaging one, you know, woolly piece of them.
Well, these dogs originally were shepherds.
Yeah, exactly. So she's not going to kill any sheep. We know that, but that just gives us extra proof. Even the sheep are comfortable with her. She's not a rogue dog.
The dog's Satan, though.
A little monster, but Lassie fights him off and hurts him, and he runs away like a little coward.
Yeah, Lassie is no pussy, despite the fact that she's been spoiled, as everyone remarks. She will fight in order to get her way.
That's right.
And continue on this journey.
An incredible journey.
Yeah, especially if she's not eating sheep.
Yeah, I mean, what is she eating?
Well, they could easily get rabbits. That's what my dog did in the country all the time. Or even in the small town, there were a lot of rabbits appearing on our lawn. That was a very disturbing human comedy type of lesson to learn. Why is my wonderful dog killing these nice rabbits?
Yeah. This movie doesn't show us any of that, right? We never see... We see Lassie eating meat prepared for her, just like humans, but we never see her kill anything.
It's really odd, though. Like, she can fight, but she won't kill? She won't kill for food?
I'm not saying that she didn't. She might have, or she probably had to, because she's in the wilderness for a long time. She does have several human assistants who put food out and milk for her, but she's got to have killed something along the way. Maybe she just ate vegetables. I don't know. Mushrooms? Anyway, the movie omits that. Does not want us to think about this dog as a predator. I think that's important. Not the whole picture of life. This is certainly not how Jack London would have presented a dog story.
Right.
I'm okay with that, but we have to reflect on what's being done here. Lassie is an angelic being. That would really spoil it to show her killing a rabbit.
Well, it depends what you mean by an angel, because as we see several times, she's able to hold her own in a fight.
Yeah, well, angels are tough, man.
Yeah,
if you read the Bible.
She's fighting Satan there.
Exactly. But she's not going to go kill a defenseless rabbit.
They know how to wrestle, angels, if you've read the Bible.
Exactly. So she swims across the River Tweed, which separates Scotland and England. I mean, it's quite a journey. There are threats of rapids. It seems like, whoa, is she going to get taken down a waterfall or something? None of that happens, but just swimming against the tide there for who knows how long. She looks really, really fucked up. So as she emerges, I mean, she drags her body along, but she can't really move and as we've said, she hasn't been eating much. She could die right here without ever getting back to Roddy McDowell. Fortunately for her, she is right outside this benevolent older couple, Dame May Whitty. And I didn't know this until just now when I read the John Douglas Eames paragraph, but I guess that's Dame May Whitty's actual husband.
Hmm.
So this older couple go out and somehow manage to get Lassie in. They look pretty frail.
Yeah, we don't see that.
No. They too start to get all kinds of ideas about what's going on inside Lassie's head. Or anyway, the wife does. And the husband finally agrees by the end that she has proven her point. Because they nurse her back to health. And as soon as she's fit to travel again, she begins to heed the call of the clock. And can't get out of the house. Doesn't fight the way she did at the kennel. Because she is grateful to these people who seem to need her. Something wonderful has come into their lonely lives out there.
Yeah, I mean, they seem very happy together. But obviously this being brings something extra into their lives, right?
And they have a nice cozy home. It looks great. But Lassie can't stay there. You know, it's got a Littlest Hobo kind of flavor to it. They've helped her. She's helping them. But now she has to go.
As this woman, Dally, says to her husband, she would stay.
But she's got somewhere else.
Because she feels sorry for them.
Yeah, but she really, if she could choose, she has to go. But yeah, she doesn't want to offend them by running away. It's got to be a mutual decision. They've got to recognize the greater importance of her mission. And it finally does come to that. The husband is a little dubious, but he agrees to participate in this experiment.
He doesn't buy initially or pretends not to buy. It's kind of like the opposite of the husband and wife from the original home.
Yeah.
He doesn't initially buy that this dog has this rich subjectivity that his wife ascribes to her.
Once he sees it in action, he can't deny it. It's clear the 4 o'clock call is greater than all of them.
See, that started reminding me of this mystical bond of love across space and time, a Borzage movie.
Yeah, Seventh Heaven.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it really is. You know, this could have been a Borzage movie too. Although I think Fred M. Wilcox does a fine job. They have to let her go. Their life has been enriched just by this one little brush with Lassie.
Deeply, I mean, this is a great performance by Dame May Whitty.
Yeah, she's a wonderful actor, of course.
Absolutely heartbreaking as she lets this dog go, because you can just feel how much is going out of her life, even though, as I said, it doesn't seem initially to have had anything missing in it, but now it will.
Yeah, and I mean, you could see it. We're prepared for that by, you know, the husband goes out asking around, has anybody lost a dog? And she is sitting there really tense, ready to crack at the first mention that someone says, yeah, that's my dog.
I don't know, is she just immediately in love with Lassie, or I think she has to be, because they could get a dog if they wanted a dog. She must just immediately fall in love with Lassie.
Yeah, and of course, you could invent all kinds of backstories. For me, this has always been, well, they had a beloved child that died, something like that.
True, but like I said, if they want a dog, they could get a dog. But somehow it has to be this dog.
A dog that fortune has brought to them.
Yeah, but the fates are fucking with them. This is a little tragic. Well, we do see these vignettes that are little tragedies.
They are, yeah. So that's part of the potency of the film. An amazing aspect of the film is the encounter with Edmund Gwenn and the part of the journey that takes place with him and Toots. You know, we've seen Edmund Gwenn a fair bit.
Speaking of Wordsworth, both that couple and Edmund Gwenn and his dog Toots are portraits of, well, these are people who are very, very happy in their couplings, but they're also redolent of extreme loneliness.
Yeah, they're isolated For sure. I mean, the older couple don't really seem to see too many people around their house. You know, their kids may be dead or too far away to come visit them. Who knows? Or never existed. They never had any. Edmund Gwen, yeah, he seems like he's chosen this life of the traveling peddler. He's got his companion, Toots.
But there's a pathos of isolation and peripateticness to it. He is himself a little as Tobo. I mean, he does have a home that he goes back to.
In the winter, yes. He stays put and I guess prepares for the next year's circuit. They are delighted to meet Lassie, and there's a brief courtship. I mean, Lassie's been through some things now and doesn't want to get sucked into anybody else's home. She doesn't want to get shot as a trespasser. She just wants to find a way to get back to Yorkshire, or that part of Yorkshire where the Carrotcloughs live. And she finally does realize Edmund Gwen is the one person she's going to meet on the road who's going to understand exactly what kind of a friendship can spring up when two loners pair up as they journey somewhere. And she briefly joins their act. We see it in one town. Toots is an amazing little dog. We spend a good amount of time with these dogs and with this man, and we get comfortable with them. We start to feel like, okay, hopefully nothing's going to happen to interrupt this idyll. But of course it does. Another two low-class scum sneak onto the scene.
They've all got these Cockney accents.
They're in the middle of Yorkshire. I don't think they should sound like that, really. Anyway, these guys are just assholes. They're gonna rob a peddler. He obviously is not rolling in dough, but they've seen him collect some dues for selling some pots, and they want to take it. They want to beat this 70-year-old man with sticks, but he's not going down without
dogs.
A fight. Yeah, well, yeah, because the dogs defend him, they pull no punches. I mean, Toots is like 5 pounds. And yeah, this guy just kills Toots right out with a stick. It's just horrifying to watch.
Lassie scares them off ultimately after this happens.
And she does retreat. It's a believable portrait of dog heroism, right? Like, she's not 100% raring to go on this fight. These guys are dangerous and she does get backed off.
And she's not a fighting dog.
No, she's a collie.
She's lived a privileged life, as we keep hearing.
But when she sees what depths these guys will stoop to, killing a 5-pound dog and threatening to beat an elderly man to death, she does throw one of them into the fire and disarm the other guy, and they run away like the cowards they are. And Edmund Gwen gets up and goes to cradle the dead Toots.
This is a very interesting epilogue to this story, in that unlike the elderly couple, he doesn't want Lassie to share his life. He's never felt like she really fit into it.
No, he recognizes the entire truth. He always has. Like, he is not deceived in any part of it. It's a road friendship that they have. And when the roads diverge, he is philosophical about it. He's like, well, I'd like it if you came along a little while longer, but if you have to go that way, I have to go this way.
And we see this man who was pretty lonely to start, much lonelier than ever. And yet he, like you say, he's very philosophical about it. He's just going to continue to live this way.
Yeah. I mean, he might get another dog to share his show with him.
But the compensation will not be perfect.
No. I think Edmund Gwen is so great in this movie. Does not disappoint.
Yeah, he's definitely not saccharine.
No.
Edmund Gwen. He's got good pathos, but he's also kind of a little bit thorny.
Lassie is almost home. I mean, she's into a city. This is dangerous for a lone dog because there are always evil dog catchers around. And these guys spot her. And again, they're just greedy pigs looking to get a little reward. Every dog they catch, presumably, they get some money.
And she would rather kill herself, apparently, than get caught by these guys.
She doesn't have a map of this town. She doesn't know where a blind alley is going to turn up and when she's going to get cornered in a factory. Because a dog can outrun a human if there's an endless amount of space. But as soon as there are any walls, it's trouble. But yeah, she jumps out a window to get away from them.
Even these dog catchers are horrified by this.
Clearly sprains something, but keeps going.
Do you think she was faking being dead for them?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, because as soon as they walk away, then she gets up and limps behind some boxes in the alley.
And she finally gets home after all of that. And I mean, this dog really sells the hardships she's endured. I just don't know how you get a a dog to do all of this incredible acting.
Well, they were so impressed by Pal that they revamped the whole movie for him.
I mean, it is impressive. How do you do that? How do you say, now you're going to pretend to be hurt?
Pal not only loved doing stunts, but was just like a great actor.
Yeah, no, I'm not going to disagree. Every minute is riveting. Every emotion is visible on the dog's face.
If there are great child actors, there are also great dog actors.
Canine is right up there with, probably my favorite is still Toto, played by Terry. I have the biography of Toto, iToto. Yeah, Pal, incredible.
Not George?
Oh, well, Skippy, yeah, who plays George and Asta. There are a lot of good dogs, there's no doubt. And Rin Tin Tin cannot be discounted either.
George fought a leopard.
That's true.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, but for real pathos, I mean, that wasn't what George did, right? That's not what Skippy did. Skippy was always a mischievous jerk in pretty much every movie. I mean, a lovable mischievous jerk. Probably the most pathos you get with that dog is in The Awful Truth, where there's the custody battle. Lassie here runs the full gamut of emotions, not even human emotions. They go beyond that. And she finally shows up at the Carrot Cloth residence, bedraggled, limping, and Elsa Lanchester and Donald Crisp can no longer contain their adoration of the dog. They spring into action to try to relieve her suffering, and Elsa Lanchester reveals that she has kept the feeding bowl. She doesn't know why. But before they can really minister to her needs all that much, it's time for school to end, and Lassie has to limp off to school to see Roddy McDowell, and she makes it. He just can't believe it. He's beside himself. His dog has returned home. And hence we have our movie title.
My Lassie Come Home.
And the final reconciliation, I mean, that brings everything together. All of our local Yorkshire residents that we care about. Hines has been dismissed. The Duke wants to hire Donald Crisp to take over the kennel. So their financial troubles are over.
We know all of this has somehow been accomplished by Elizabeth Taylor.
Yeah, she's worked her wonders behind the scenes.
She's the good angel whispering to him.
We have this scene where the legalities are also respected and confirmed. The Duke has to disclaim ownership of this dog. Everyone has to winkingly agree, this can't be Lassie. It's impossible. It must be just another collie.
Right, which is, in that moment, it's that kind of comedy ending that exists in a different universe from the rest of the movie, because for one thing, Nigel Bruce is suddenly so much more intelligent than he's been the entire time in order to pronounce the words that this dog can't belong to me. I don't own her.
Well, again, I think what you're saying is true. It's Elizabeth Taylor's influence. They've been talking all the way back from Scotland.
Yeah, and we haven't been shown that, and we don't need to. All we need to see is the transformation.
Donald Crisp doesn't have to feel like a thief. You know, they made their bargain. He sold Lassie. Lassie's not back. This is some other dog, so he's allowed to keep her. Even the new owner agrees.
Well, it's a new dispensation, so she might as well be a new dog.
That's right. I mean, presumably Roddy McDowell is still going to keep calling her Lassie, but nobody's going to question that or haul him off to jail.
Yes, but still, despite the declaration that the true ownership of this dog belongs to these Yorkshire people, nevertheless, the dog is going to be at the kennel.
Cared for at the kennel, yes, but obviously can go home anytime she wants and is still, I'm sure, running to see Roddy McDowell after school every day. But she also gets to breed with some of the dogs at the kennel and have a nice little troop of cubs that Nigel Bruce can show off at important canine shows.
So it really is like a marriage between the classes.
It is. Married through the dogs, which you don't see very often.
You kind of do in that one weird Billy Wilder musical.
Bing Crosby also gets married. Here it's just the dog.
But, so far, but well, Elizabeth Taylor and Roddy McDowell, we can all dream for their future.
Yeah, I think we can picture 10 years from now, they might be walking down the aisle.
Although they barely interact, I was expecting more interaction.
No, but it's very meaningful interaction. She is thinking a lot about Roddy McDowell and his subjectivity as well, not just the dog.
And that's why I'm saying Elizabeth Taylor in this role is so important, because she can make you believe that about her.
It's a star-making performance, and I mean, MGM did take note and started putting her in bigger and bigger things.
Well, there is also the fact that she is pretty you're naturally beautiful.
Sure, but hard to use a child who's 11. Not young enough to be a moppet and not old enough to have any kind of a love story. So what do you do with them? We'll see what MGM did with her. National Velvet is coming up. More animals. So we have No Fear and movie going in Toronto this week. We didn't get to any movies at the cinema, unfortunately. Next week, however, we do have a treat for you, I think. 4 movies directed by Jacqueline Audry. It is our May special subject. We did see Olivia at the Paradise Theater a couple of years ago, or I guess 4 years ago now, and we talked about that a little bit, I think. But we are going to be watching basically all of the movies that had English subtitles for Jacqueline Audry. So we're going to watch Gigi, not the Hollywood version, the original. Olivia, Reclos, so No Exit, and Les Petits Matins. So that's going to span from 1948 to 1962. Looking forward to that greatly.
Mm-hmm.